Well met, everyone. I am Rich DeLitch. In today's video, we're going to take a look at a Netflix trailer that I saw a day or two ago. It is called Shadow and Bone. I know nothing about it. It looked really cool. It has a very fantastical element to it, so it's certainly fitting for something Dungeons and Dragons-esque. I believe it's based on a book or a best-selling novel. I don't know if this is a trailer for a Netflix movie or if this is an upcoming TV series, TV show, but I believe it's going to be releasing sometime in April. But what I'm going to do is we're going to watch that trailer together. It's less than 3 minutes, so we'll all sit back and I'll put it on screen. We'll watch it, and then I'll break it down and I'll put it into my five-bullet system. My five-bullet system of creating content for your game, for getting some gameplay to the table, has always done quite well as far as videos go. It seems to be that a lot of people really latch onto that and they get a lot of value out of it. So I decided to do it again, but do it a little more spontaneously, sort of on the fly, and simply show and indicate that you can watch anything, you can read anything, you can be inspired by anything. And if you think through the five-point bullet system, you can use that and chunk all of that goodness down into something that you can actually bring to the table. Okay, so let's sit back and let's watch this trailer right now for Shadow and Bone.
The Shadow Fold. A scar on the map. That tore our country in two.
What the hell are you doing here?
I'll make it. Promise.
To destroy it, we need a miracle.
Saw what happened.
We were attacked. And then there was a searing light.
Lift up your sleeve.
What are you?
Going to change the world.
There it is. Pretty cool, right? Really neat. So, it must be said, very important, I know nothing about Shadow and Bone, I know nothing about the book, I know nothing else about Shadow and Bone other than what we just saw. That's all I know about it, and that's all I need. I just need that little 2.5 minutes, and from that, I can extrapolate further, wrangle in my creativity and put some walls and boundaries around it, get 5 bullet points down, and use that to create a 6 to 8 hour game. To inject that into my campaign, perhaps use that as the launch point for a new campaign, bring it into some sort of an adventure, whatever. And I want to just simply use this video and use that trailer to show you how you can do that with anything. You read a really cool chapter in a book? Create 5 bullet points from it. Put it in your journal. Put those 5 bullets in your journal, even if you don't use them immediately. They will grow into something that you can use to create gameplay. At the end of the day, folks, as Dungeon Masters, it is not the inspiration we take in, it's what we can actually bring to the table, what's going to get us through a weekend, what's going to get us through a session. something that's playable, right? Well, I'm not using this trailer to inspire me to make my own movie trailer, to make my own novel and book series. I'm using this as inspiration to help me when I'm stuck, but I have a game to run tonight, and I don't know what adventure I want them to go on, okay? So, based on what we saw in that trailer, here's 5 bullet points. I'm going to put them all on screen right now. These are just my 5 bullet points. Once again, it's purely coincidental if something latches or leans into what's really there in the book, okay? First one, woman sees world-ending stuff and saves the day. Second one, people question her existence. Rumors, legends, myth, and superstition start to come into play. Something should have gone worse, right? It was a catastrophe, an attack by these creatures of night, this darkness, and a female that didn't even know perhaps that she had the power, as she mentioned in that trailer, I'm just a map maker, I'm just a cartographer. Didn't even know she had this power, apparently saved the day. And witnesses have said, something happened and this chick shot all this radiant light and energy and pushed the forces of darkness away. So now there's a bunch of rumors circling around, like how long has she had this power? Who is she? So on and so forth. The third bullet point, she meets the main person that's been lurking with a dark secret. He's the one that scratched at her arm and said, you know, who are you? What are you? Whatever. Okay? So there we have a secret NPC that we're going to kind of play with. The fourth one, others that demonstrate power are starting to show up. This is one where this was the very vague part of the trailer for me since I know nothing about the source material, but I just saw people doing things, right? There was somebody in a tavern, there was somebody in the woods, looked like telekinetic powers and, you know, force powers or whatever, right? The manifestation or mutants are starting to show up a la X-Men now that one mutant has revealed themselves to sort of by necessity had to do something in order to save the world and push away the darkness. And then the fifth one is when he says we're going to change the world and he's inside of that cathedral or whatever, that courthouse. And then you see the shadow and the darkness start to come in towards the end of the trailer. And that's kind of the dark and light. She's the light, he's the darkness. They meet up and together, if you take black and white, they create a very gray world. So let's reiterate one more time. Those are my 5 bullet points. Bullet point number one, in no particular order, but these are the 5 anchors of the gameplay that I'd be bringing to my table. A woman sees some world-ending stuff, and by necessity, her power is unleashed, and she saves the day, right? Maybe a lot of people die, a nation is destroyed, but the entire world is saved because she pushes it away. She doesn't allow the catastrophe to become worse than it is. The second bullet point, rumors, legends, superstition, everything that circles around that catastrophic event and who was that mysterious lady that had that power. Number 3, she meets with the secret NPC. The one that has a power lurking, and maybe he's been looking for someone like her all along. There's a certain lock, if you will, sort of a metaphor or an analogy. Something that needs to be unlocked in this world. And he's one half of the key, and he doesn't know where the other half is. But now that she's revealed herself, there it is. The fourth bullet point, others in the world, others are starting to demonstrate this power. And then the fifth one, dark and light, black and white meet to create a grayness. And what's the new world going to look like from there, okay? So as we kind of take these 5 bullet points further, let's look at the first one. A woman sees world-ending stuff and saves the day. Here's where I'm going with it in the D&D space now. What we have is we have an Asimar, right? You know the Asimar are, you know, heritage, ancestry, born of celestial, but yet they are still considered humanoids. This female, whether it's an NPC or it's one of your characters, one of your PCs, is an Asimar, fallen, protector, scourge, whatever, okay? Probably something a little nicer, so what is the one? The fallen, not the fallen. But they're an Asimar, they're humanoid, but all of a sudden, something triggers, right? A demonic invasion, a portal opens up, and there's this, the Underdark comes, Kyber or something like this, comes out, and that's how you introduce this, right? To an NPC or to a player. Some event happens, and this Asimar is forced to unleash power that they didn't know they had. And radiant energy, right? And where this is coming from is when he scratched on her arm and we saw that golden glow of light. She's made of pure celestial essence and energy. So they are not just the humanoid. They actually have the celestial subtype or the celestial type, right? So what is it? Divine sense. She would show up on that thing. They're not humanoids anymore. She's not, at least. So that's the first bullet point. That's where I want to go with it. We have an Asimar. Again, PC or NPC. The second one, people are starting to question her existence. Like, who is she? You know, who is she? Where is she from? What does that signify? Rumors, legends, myths, superstition. Each of those things, each rumor, each legend, each myth, each superstition, each village, town, hamlet, city they go into that's talking about her can start to poke at all these little quest hooks, all these little storylines to learn more about her. How long has she been here? And we learn that she's traveled from the Celestial Bridge. She actually came down, but she doesn't know this yet. She's discovering this. So I think as we start to go further into this, my mind is starting to go, and this is real time. I'm doing this right here as I'm talking. Yes, I kind of thought through the five bullet points after I watched the trailer last time, a couple of days ago, but where I'm going with them right now is happening live on camera, okay? I'm starting to think that I think this should be more of an NPC. And the NPC is kind of the one cool thing I saw that is something I always like to lean into now. Find your old guy that lives up in the mountains, your hermit, that owns dragons, that hands out quests. Who is your quest giver? Right? And this NPC and everything surrounding her is the reason that all of these adventure hooks and all these stories that the PCs can explore further. Okay? Because as legends and myth and rumors, you're going to have a cult that perhaps is talking doom and gloom. They say, we knew the darkness was coming and that damn woman stopped us. So they want to kill her. So now the PCs find out that, yes, this woman saved the day. She's obviously important to some world prophetic storyline, but you probably want to keep her around because she just sort of was a band-aid, right? She just pushed the darkness away. She didn't get rid of it forever. It's going to come back. You might need to keep her alive. So right there, you now have a very sort of bodyguard protection mission on board that the PCs can kind of latch onto. Find out where she is and protect her. Or find out who the biggest threats are to her, go to them and take them out before they get to her. So it's a little more proactive. Rather than sitting back and defending, they now have to go in and attack the forces that they've learned about through rumor, superstition, myth, legend, whatever. Right? And it could be word of mouth. They're learning as they're talking to people. You know, streetwise, I guess, in a cyberpunk concept. The thief of your party doing some investigation checks. Learning about, you know, what are the whispers that are kind of moving through the alleyways and in the dark cellars and at the gambling halls and, you know what I mean, in the taverns late at night. What are people whispering? And you learn that there's this cult that worships that darkness. And she's the key figure they need to take out. Otherwise, the darkness will never envelop the world. So now the PCs have guard her, meaning where is she? We need to find her and get to her quickly. Or perhaps more of a like old school D&D henchman concept, right? Like have your paladin start to recruit varying guilds and forces of light, good aligned gods, and say, hey, we can't guard her. We don't have the means or whatever reason. We're going to go ahead and go on the other quest line, which is we're going to attack the forces that are going to go and harm her anyway. We're going to meet them, you know, up front. But we want to hire you and recruit you. And you need to go over to this town and this city where she is and protect her. Until we give you the all clear that all the threats are gone, go protect her. So you notice those first two bullet points give us so much to lean into, right? The third one. This is the hard one. She meets the main person that's been lurking with this secret. There isn't a dark entity. Maybe that person, and again, I don't know the source material, so I don't know if he truly is. This is coincidental here if it is. Maybe that person is responsible for that darkness. Maybe he does know who she is and he's playing, right? He doesn't want a House Dimir concept from Ravnica, right? He's playing it cool. But he knows what's going on. He's part of the world-ending thing. But there's something that he plays into there with her, right? So he's not just looking at her as that cult is where, okay, she showed up. She stopped the darkness that I'm kind of supposed to be overseeing and making sure it happens, but I don't want to just kill her because she plays some key role. Maybe he's an NPC that can be flipped onto the side of good. Maybe he's an evil guy, but he can be changed. He can be coerced to do the right thing, whatever it may be. But notice now you're looking at socio-political intrigue. You're dealing with something that's not necessarily combative because maybe he's too powerful. He's like Strahd, and your PCs are just starting out in the adventure. So maybe the PCs start to deal with the exploration and social aspect of gameplay rather than just outright combat. There's a combat pillar of gameplay right there with the cults. But now they're dealing into, there's a big bad guy there, and maybe he finds her, and he now has her, and he's playing as though he's the protector, but maybe he, the one who's supposed to be the savior and the bodyguard for her, is actually the one that ultimately is looking to backstab her or something like this, right? And you can kind of weave into that, and that can play into a lot right there, okay? Others, the fourth bullet point, others are starting to demonstrate powers throughout the world. Are they related? Or is it more of like that was the key trigger event that everyone in the world, including the PCs, think of how fun and cool that would be if you create these little like homebrew powers or feats. Let's just say a feat and you leave them. But after this event happens, these dormant feats come on board. And now you tell each of your PCs the start of next session or whatever, you have this, you have this power, you have this power. You have that power. And there's these trigger events that are activated. That was the key world trigger event. And ever since that happened, you now have these powers that are now kind of giving you a role to play in this whole storyline. Like you have the ability to snuff out small parts, little pockets of darkness as they're encroaching upon the world. She's the big player, right? She clearly has that massive radiant sun level energy that pushed the darkness away. You have all these smaller powers. But you and others are starting to demonstrate. But now, what about the ones that are demonstrating powers on the other side? The dark powers. The ones that are opening up these small little doors that's allowing the darkness to creep through and form into this much bigger darkness. So use kind of the X-Men concept, right? Like a mutant was first discovered and now all of a sudden all the mutants are starting to come on board. And they're starting to have all these trigger events that are unlocking all their powers. But just think of how cool, you know, the barkeeper, the tavern owner is now manifesting this power. This guy is manifesting that power. The NPC halfling that they used to, the farmer that they're hanging out with is now manifesting arcane or divine energy. What are the ramifications or how does that lean into the gods in your world? Are the gods doing that? You know what I mean? Like there's a lot going on just from that fourth bullet point, especially when you attach it directly to the PCs. That makes it really fun and exciting because you're giving them something, but it was unlocked until now. But now there's a reason. It's like you have it, but you have it because you're supposed to do something with it. And if they don't lean into this storyline, you don't have to outwardly say it as a dungeon master, but what if you start giving that hint that, you know, or they just start to believe if they don't do something with it, they might lose it. It's awesome to get +2 to all your stats and a new feat or whatever it may be, right? To unleash and unlock this new power. But if you don't do something with it, you might be in jeopardy. You know, they always say more. What is it? Would you rather be given $1,000 or have $1,000? I don't know. I'm butchering it. But would you rather be given $1,000 or have $1,000 stolen from you? It hurts more to have to feel and taste something and have it taken away than just to not ever have that to begin with, right? So that's a really cool thing. And then the fifth one I think is the most interesting because you always want to have something in your bullet points that leads into the next adventure, the next storyline, or, okay, we kind of finished up act one of the story. Now what? When you start answering that question of where do we go from here? The dark and light. She's this force of light, right? I think from what I saw in the beginning of the trailer, she pushed all that energy away. But then when they're inside of that cathedral or wherever they were, where all the nobles are sort of standing around them, maybe she's going to be interrogated, right? You know, like, who are you and why are you here? And what, you know, what doom are you prophesizing? And then all of a sudden, his powers have unlocked as well. And together, they're starting to create this weird swarming necrotic energy that's kind of coming into this cathedral, and now it defiles the lawful good main temple or something like this. So now you have these forces of black and white, and I'm looking at it from an actual design colorist perspective. When you have the darkness and the light meet up, all that's created in the middle is this muddied gray, this muted color, and it's just, it's not purely darkness because there's a light aspect coming from her, but it's also not just pure radiant boon and blessings, right? There's horrors here. But it's just this gray fugue or something like that. It's just this weirdness. And that's what's happening now that they're together. So do you need to separate them? Do you need to kill one of the two? And so on and so forth. But you can kind of lean into a lot more of that, you know. There, I mean, you're really looking at campaign-ending, catastrophic world-ending sort of apocalyptic stuff. But that's it. I mean, there's a lot to go off of. But you notice, we had 2.5 minutes and 5 bullet points. Most importantly, the wheels are turning. Every bullet point starts to ask questions. As you and the player start answering those questions, that is how gameplay is built. Inspiration is everywhere. Every book, every comic, every piece of art, every picture. Walk outside. Take a walk to the mailbox. Walk around your block. Whatever. Just walk. You will see it. And when you start chunking through and thinking through this bullet point system, you start creating pillars that you can kind of anchor and chain to. And those form your pillars of gameplay. And that is how you can take something so small and allow it to go further into an entire campaign. Or something as grand as an entire book like Middle Earth or Tolkien, right? Lord of the Rings. And shrink it down into these 5 little bullet points to get me through 4 hours of gameplay. Just some food for thought. That's all I have for you guys. See you soon.